Stephen's down here, and the Lord is going to bless us tonight. I know it. As we bless him, let's pray. Lord, we just thank you so much that we can gather tonight, Lord, in your name. And Lord, we just want to bow at your feet, Lord, at your throne, God. And just acknowledge, Lord, that how much we need you, and thank you that you have rescued us from the miry clay, the pit. Lord, and we can walk on a firm foundation tonight, Lord. We just love you so much. Would you please be with us? And Lord, we just want to get a glimpse, Lord, of your glory tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Sin and shame, they were like prisons that we couldn't escape. But he came and he died and he rose. Those walls are rubble now. Remember those giants we call death and grave, they were like mountains that stood on our way. But he came and he died and he rose. Well, the giants are dead now. This is our God, this is who he is. He loves us. This is our God, this is what he does. He saves us. Upon the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim. This is our God, King Jesus. Remember that fear that took our breath away. Faith so weak that we could barely pray. But he heard every word, every whisper. Now those altars in the wilderness, they tell the story of his faithfulness. Never once did he fail, and he never will. This is our God, this is who he is. He loves us. This is our God, this is what he does. He saves us. Upon the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim. This is our God, King Jesus. Who pulled me out of that pit? He did, he did. Who paid for all of our sin? Nobody but Jesus. Who rescued me from that grave? Yahweh, Yahweh. Who gets the glory and praise? Nobody but Jesus. Who rescued me from that grave? Yahweh, Yahweh. Who gets the glory and praise? Nobody but him. This is our God, this is who he is. He loves us. This is our God, this is what he does. He saves us. For the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim. This is our God, King Jesus. For the cross, beat the grave. Let heaven and earth proclaim. This is our God, King Jesus.
I want to thank everybody for the prayers for my surgery. Things are going really good. But I have a story to tell, because yesterday I was at physical therapy, and there was another guy that the instructor said, you guys are just going to stick together. And so we're doing these exercises. They seemed kind of familiar, but they weren't. Something was really weird. The more he talked, it was like, he goes, yeah, you got to do this one right, or they might have to go back in. And I'm like, what is going on here? And so at the very end of the session, he puts an ice pack on my knee, and I said, You do realize it was on my hip, that not a knee replacement. So the whole time he was doing the knee replacement exercises. So, yeah. So anyway.
So his knee is much stronger.
Yeah, yeah. So anyway, yeah. Yeah. Pretty funny. Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my meditation. Walking unto the voice of my cry, my King and my God. For unto thee will I pray, my voice shalt thou hear in the morning. O Lord, in the morning will I direct my prayer unto thee, and will look up. Give ear to my words, O Lord. Consider my meditation. Hearken unto the voice of my cry, my King and my God. For unto thee will I pray, my voice shalt thou hear in the morning. O Lord, in the morning will I direct my prayer unto thee, and will my words, O Lord. Consider my meditation. Hearken unto the voice of my cry, my King and my God. For unto thee will I pray, my voice shalt thou hear in the morning. O Lord, in the morning will I direct my prayer unto thee, and will look up. O Lord, in the morning will I direct my prayer unto thee, and will look up. O Lord, in the morning will I direct my prayer unto thee, and will look
forgiven, 'cause you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned, and I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven, and I'm forgiven, 'cause you were forsaken, and I'm accepted. You were condemned, but I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me, because you died and rose again. Amazing love. Amazing love, oh, just by joining one of you. In all I do, I honor you. And I've been given because you were forsaken. And I'm accepted, you were condemned. And I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Based on love, how can it be? See, my King would die for me. By joining one of you, in all I do, I honor you. You are my King. You are my King. Jesus, you are my King. Jesus, you are my King. Based in love, how can it be? See, my King would die for me. Based in love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you. All I do, I honor you. In all I do, I honor you.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, and I will sing of the goodness of God.
I love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, and I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, and I will sing of the goodness of God.
Love your voice.
I love your voice. You have led me through the fire and darkest night. You are close like no other. Known you as a father, known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. So good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is burning heaven for me.
All my life.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able,
I will sing of the goodness of God. And I will sing of the goodness of God. And I will sing of the goodness of God. Amen. Dave, would you pray?
Father, we love you. Thanks so much for this evening, the time together. We pray that you would bless the teaching of your word through Adam, that you would speak through him. God, we just so appreciate being able to come together and worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I want to say hi to somebody.
Say hi to someone.
No worries. Oh, good evening, everyone. I think winter is finally here. Yes. When I woke up, it was 37. Yes. Green Valley Lake. Where are we at? 32. You guys ready for the snow?
No.
Oh, no. He said the S word. All right. So, a few announcements for you tonight. First off, marriage ministry this Friday night. Couples, come on out for that. 6:30, we're going with an Italian theme. Michelle and I will be making chicken parmesan over some spaghetti. So, anything that can accommodate that. Otherwise, if you have questions, please contact my lovely wife. Ladies, they are having another paint night. So, that's going to be Friday, November 17th. 6:30. Signups are in the foyer. It is limited. If you have any questions about this, talk to Darla. Also, we have our chili cook-off coming up November 12th, 5 to 7. Signups are in the foyer. If you have any questions about this, come see me. You see, you don't need a barbecue to cook chili. Okay. So let me explain this. So I had a neighbor who was a bioprevaricator. He couldn't tell the truth. So he tells me, he goes, "Oh, you're having a chili cook-off at your church? Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, you know, I got Jesse from the Dukes of Hazzard? Well, I knew him. And you see, he gave me the best chili recipe ever. And I mean, it would just blow everybody away. But, you know, I don't have a barbecue or anything like that. So I can't cook chili." Now, my partner at the time, his family actually used to go to chili cookouts. I mean, they would get there in the morning and they'd set up, you know, their pot over the fire and stuff and do all the stuff for chili cook-offs. And I asked him, I said, "Did you ever use a barbecue?" He was like, "No." No self-respecting chili cook-off would ever show up with a barbecue. But my neighbor had Uncle Jesse's recipe. So even if you don't have Uncle Jesse's recipe, I encourage you, come on out. It's going to be wonderful. And if you don't make chili, then maybe make a side. Some nice cornbread to go with that or something along those lines. Anyway, I encourage you all. I'm sorry? Outside? It's cold outside, Nancy. No, it'll be inside here. We'll set up the foyer, either the foyer or the multipurpose room with all the chilies and everything like that, and set up a few tables. It'll be a wonderful time. Wonderful time. big prizes too, so come on out for that. Lastly, kids, fifth grade, preschool through fifth grade, are encouraged to participate in our Christmas service Sunday, December 17th at 10 a.m. for the kids' choir, okay? Sign up for that. We need a firm commitment for that. So don't have your kids show up Christmas service and expect them to be singing if they haven't exercised their vocal cords and aren't familiar with the songs. All the months that they're going to practice for that. If you have any questions on this, talk to either Mark or Joan if you want your child to participate. And that is it on the announcements this evening. We are going to take a look at Ezekiel chapter 24 this evening. Now, many cities today are called melting pots. Because of the large number of immigrants and the tendency for those ethnic groups to come together and assimilate into culture over time. You know, growing up in New York City was called a melting pot, and it truly was. You had Little Italy, you had Chinatown, you had all these different immigrants who came together, by the way, legally came there through Ellis Island over the days, and became part of the American dream. And just like Lady Liberty says, give us your sick, lame, and lazy because we're stupid enough to take them. Okay, that's not what's actually on there. What it says is give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free. See, people come to this country for the freedoms that we have, the rights that were given to us by God. Now, Jerusalem was also a melting pot of cultures. But around 588 BC, the city became a melting pot for a different reason, as we're going to find out tonight. See, the Babylonian siege then lasted for about 2 years, and it culminated with the fall of the city of Jerusalem. Hundreds of miles away, though, over in Babylon, the Lord told Ezekiel to utter a parable about a pot of stew. And we're going to see that in Ezekiel 24, verses 3 through 5. Jerusalem was portrayed as a stewed pot full of water, choice meats and spices with fuel bones or logs blazing underneath. Some believe that Ezekiel's parable was based upon a folk song commonly sung by women at that time as they prepared their food. It would have been like, I remember from my youth, peas porridge hot, peas porridge cold, peas porridge in the pot 5 days old. Anybody else remember that? Yeah, all right, good, good. So I'm not just dating myself here. All right. The Lord may have very well turned that little ditty of a song into a powerful spiritual lesson for the Israelites. Now, the allusion provided is the recipe for cooking up a yummy stew. But the parable that we're going to see here, it's got some problems with the preparation. Primarily, scum. Now, the Hebrew word for scum is chelah, and it means disease, impurities, or rust on a metal pot. And it was the symbolism of impurity of Jerusalem. So the scum or the rust in the pot was spoiling the stew so that nobody would want to eat it. By this analogy, the sin of God's people in Jerusalem had made them become unpleasant and distasteful. The Lord's remedy was to turn up the heat. We're going to see that in verse 9. So much so that the water would eventually evaporate. The meat would burn up. The pot would turn red hot and the scum would burn off. We're going to see that in verses 10 and 11. You know, this technique was also used by my son, Andrew, when he would do the dishes. You see, he'd get a pot or a pan that had some baked-on food that he just didn't really feel like scrubbing hard enough. So he'd fill it up with water, and then he'd put it onto the stove. Well, he'd go back to washing the rest of the dishes, and then when he was done with the dishes, he'd walk away, forgetting completely about that pot. Then sometime later in that evening, I'd walk into the kitchen going, and there would be the pot, completely empty, no water in it, and now that food that he was trying to help bake off was baked into the pan, and it was next to impossible to go ahead and remove. So, in essence, what God is saying here in our scripture is that God was going to cleanse the city of its impurities. It was essentially what the Babylonian siege accomplished. Now, in thinking about cities today, the image of the boiling pot, I believe, is still applicable. You see, if a city is relatively healthy and it can stand a certain amount of heat or can even profit from it. Think about our little community last winter. As here it is, families came together, neighbors came together, churches came together within the community, banding together, even though there was the pressure of not being able to get around. So kind of an opposite of turning up the heat in the middle of the winter, but you get my point. Now, to some extent, heat and pressure are necessary to fully cook the diverse ingredients and meld them together into something that is enjoyable and nutritious. So, for example, I was talking about chili. So many times, doesn't it always taste better the next day? Right? Yes, or like a soup or something that my beautiful wife has made. Right? But on the other hand, when the city is when it ignores its problems, and it allows for a spiritual and a moral decline that can go unchecked, the increase of the heat can be explosive. Or in a worst case scenario, you can see a meltdown. And we saw that all across this country with the BLM riots and riots overall. But like my example with Andrew and the dishes, it'll just make it worse. So what's happening to Jerusalem when Babylon conquers it? Well, we're going to take a look at that tonight. We're going to take a look at not just that melting pot, but also Ezekiel. He's going to lose his wife. But God tells Ezekiel not to mourn or weep, just as God will not mourn over the punishment of his nation, Israel, due to their sin. And they deserve the consequences they received. It's never easy when we lose the desire of our eyes. We're going to get a glimpse of just what God went through with the Jews. And maybe this might be something that he's going through with you and with me, with each and every one of us, as we sin, as we walk away from his laws and statutes. So tonight, we're going to take a look at those items and so much more. So would you join me as we delve into chapter 24 in the book of Ezekiel? Tonight, the message, melting pots and mournings. But before we get into that, let's pray. Precious Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time spent together. We thank you for this time spent in your word. Lord, so many times we can come to your word and it can be cryptic and difficult to understand. Well, Lord, I pray that you would open up the hearts and minds of each and every one of us tonight, that as we delve in, as we discuss the relationships, the analogies that are here within your word, that you would bring clarity, that you would bring understanding. And Lord, that we would leave here a little bit better, changed, a little bit more knowing, closer in relationship to you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for the blessings and the time spent together. Your word does not return void. Know how much we love you, we praise you, and it's in Jesus' precious name that we pray. Amen. Amen. So open up into your Bibles to chapter 24, starting off in verse 1. Again, in the ninth year, in the tenth month, on the tenth day of the month, the word of the Lord came to me saying, Son of man, write down the name of the day. This very day, the king of Babylon started his siege against Jerusalem this very day. All right, so just within these first two verses, a bunch of points that are here. First of all, this is the fourth chronological reference given by Ezekiel. We see that in chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. Now it came to pass in the 13th year, in the fourth month, on the fifth day of the year, I was among the captives by the river Chebar, that the heavens were opened, and I saw visions of God on the fifth day of the month, which was in the fifth year of King Jehoiachin's captivity. Then we saw it again in chapter 8, verse 1. And it came to pass in the sixth year, in the sixth month, on the fifth day of the month, that as I sat in my house with the elders of Judah sitting before me, that the hand of the Lord fell upon me there. And then again in chapter 20, verse 1, it came to pass in the seventh year, in the fifth month, on the tenth day of the month, that certain of the elders of Israel came to inquire of the Lord and sat before me. And then we see it today again in our scripture. So maybe you're sitting there and you're like, okay, Adam, so what's the big deal? Ezekiel went ahead and he wrote a couple of dates. So what? You know, I was listening to a podcast the other day, and the title of it is, I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist. And it's with Dr. Frank Turek, who was interviewing Joel P. Kramer, who was an archaeologist. And I encourage you, check out his YouTube site. The YouTube channel is called Expedition Bible. He's not just an archaeologist, but he's one of the leading archaeologists over in Israel. He was born and raised in the Middle East, all amongst the digs that were there. And do you know, however, what the number one map he used for finding most of the digs that he worked on? The Bible. The Bible. You see, the beauty of this is that there are so many modern-day skeptics and Bible critics that when you can go to a passage, have something written about somebody in some town or tomb happening in a certain year, and then you find the excavation that is consistent or collaborates those events, it just confirms what we all already know. The Bible is truth. Amen? Yes. It also validates those stories, times, and history of the Bible. So in this passage, the date that's given is January 588 BC. Not only does Ezekiel say this, but we also know that in history, the king of Babylon at that time was King Nebuchadnezzar, who started his two-year siege against Jerusalem. So I want to give you guys a little bit of history. So going back into 586 BC, the Babylonian military led by King Nebuchadnezzar succeeded in breaking a two-year-long siege and destroyed much of the city of Jerusalem. They tore down the walls, they tore down the palaces, and they tore down the Temple of Solomon. So that was the first temple. There was a second one that was built, right? And that one, as we're going to see on Sunday, Jesus is going to prophesy or predict that that one will be torn down as well. But there's going to be a third temple, isn't there? Mm-hmm. Coming to a temple mount near you soon. Now, from a worldly perspective, Nebuchadnezzar was continuing his mission to secure and grow a resurrected Babylonian empire. We know it today as the Neo-Babylonian Empire. However, we know that it was just really God using Nebuchadnezzar to accomplish his will against his rebellious people. Now, years earlier, he had made Judah already part of his empire. Take a look at 2 Kings chapter 24, verse 1. And it states, in his days, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up, and Jehoiakim became his vassal for 3 years. Then he turned and rebelled against him. So the Jews were required to give an annual tribute, a yearly tribute to Nebuchadnezzar. But when the Jerusalem's king Jehoiakim rebelled, Nebuchadnezzar besieged the city and won. That was at 597 BC. But instead of destroying it, he forced many into exile. King Jehoiakim, much of the royal family, the courts, nobility, priesthood, and the military. Nebuchadnezzar then appoints a new king, who would also end up being the last king of Jerusalem, Zedekiah. So take a look now at 2 Kings 24, verses 10 through 17. At that time, the servants of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came up against Jerusalem, and the city was besieged. And Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came against the city, and his servants were besieging it. Then Jehoiachin, king of Judah, his mother, his servants, his princes, and his officers went out to the king of Babylon. And the king of Babylon, in the eighth year of his reign, took him prisoner. And he carried out from there all the treasures of the house of the Lord and the treasures of the king's house. And he cut it in pieces, all the articles of gold which Solomon, king of Israel, had made in the temple of the Lord, as the Lord had said. Also, he carried into captivity all Jerusalem, all the captains and the mighty men of valor, 10,000 captives, and all the craftsmen and smiths. None remained except the poorest people of the land. And he carried Jehoiachin captive to Babylon. The king's mother, king's wife, his officers, and the mighty men of the land he carried into captivity from Jerusalem to Babylon. All the valiant men, 7,000, and craftsmen and smiths, 1,000, all who were strong and fit for war, these the king of Babylon brought captivity to Babylon. See, then Judah rebelled against King Zedekiah, under King Zedekiah, against Nebuchadnezzar. And you know what? This time, Nebuchadnezzar must not have been feeling so charitable. As our scripture stated at the beginning, he begins a two-year siege against them. Now, this military campaign sets up, you have the invading army all around Jerusalem, cutting off all the supplies and killing and or taking prisoners, anybody trying to go into the city or coming out. However, a few generations before this siege, King Hezekiah had brought a fresh water supply into Jerusalem as through an underground aqueduct. Now, while we were over in Jerusalem, we got to go through these. So I'm going to show you a couple of pictures up here onto the screen that I took. The first one is an artist's rendition. And as you see here in the center of the screen, you've got that kind of diagonal stairway, right, going down, or actually it was going up from the springs, and it was protected so that in the event of a siege against the city of Jerusalem, the people wouldn't run out of water. Now in the next one, this was going down to the springs. And I was just struck. I was amazed at this. Because you know what? This wasn't done with jackhammers and dynamite. No, this was done with chisels and hammers. And it was an intricate labyrinth all through a network, all through, so that the city of Jerusalem wouldn't run out of water. Now, the next picture is awesome. That's the actual spring of Gihon. And Jewish tradition stated that this was the place where the kings of Judah were anointed, here at this very pool, this very spring. And we see this in scripture. 1 Kings chapter 1, verses 33 through 34 states, excuse me, and King David said, call to me Zadok the priest, Nathan the prophet, and Benaniah the son of Jehoiada. So they came before the king. The king also said to them, take with you the servants of your Lord, and have Solomon my son ride on my own mule, or a donkey. Sound familiar, folks? Right? And take him down to Gihon, or the springs at Gihon, to that area, that blue-colored spring. There let Zadok the priest and Nathan the prophet anoint him king over Israel, and blow the horn and say, long live King Solomon. Now, again, there were many different ducts or avenues. And in the next picture, what you're going to see here is that it was in a vast tunnel. And I don't know, you really can't read it, but the top sign there says Hezekiah's Tunnel, which brings us right back to our timeline. So King Nebuchadnezzar is playing this waiting game. He's got the city surrounded. The city has water. But eventually, everyone would begin to starve as all the food sources were cut off from Jerusalem citizens. So after 2 years, it's exactly what happens. And the Babylonians even built a siege wall around the city, additionally, to stop anyone trying to escape, even which King Zedekiah eventually tried to do. We see that in 2 Kings 25:5. But when the city's walls fell and it was breached, the Babylonians went in and he was captured. So the Bible and archaeology agree, at least on a portion of the city being burned. Take a look at 2 Kings 25:9. It tells that Nebuchadnezzar burned the house of the Lord and the king's house, all the houses of Jerusalem, that is, all the houses of the great, he burned with fire. So during the excavations in the 1960s of Jerusalem, burnt houses dating from this time period were found. They were totally uncovered. Now the next picture, what you see here, is the 1975 excavations. Four arrowheads were found in that layer of ash at the base of Jerusalem's one of their ancient defensive towers. And note the ash and the charcoal that's around them. So once again, digs like these confirm the validity of our Bibles, which brings us back to Ezekiel. Ezekiel was commanded to write down the name of the day. What day? The day of the siege by Nebuchadnezzar. This would be a bitter reminder of God's trustworthiness to do what he promised and through all the prophets. Again, Nebuchadnezzar's siege was God's judgment on Jerusalem. So God is going to have Ezekiel write down a parable about the rebellious house. In other words, Israel, and more specifically, Jerusalem. So coming back to our scripture in chapter 24, verse 3, "And utter a parable to the rebellious house and say to them, thus says the Lord God, put on a pot, set it on, and also pour water into it. Gather pieces of meat in it, every good piece, the thigh and the shoulder. Fill it with choice cuts. Take the choice of the flock. Also pile fuel bones under it. Make it boil well and let the cuts simmer in it." So again, the subject of this parable is explained in verse 2, which is who? Jerusalem, but specifically Israel as a whole. The audience was, again, the rebellious house, Israel as they're called. And we see the flock, once again, symbolic of God's chosen people, the Jewish people. Now, the bones in here can either represent logs or actual bones that they would use sometimes in order to fuel the fires. Continuing in verse 6. "Therefore, thus says the Lord God, woe to the bloody city, to the pot whose scum is in it, and whose scum is not gone from it. Bring it out piece by piece, on which no lot has fallen." So the bloody city helps explain why Jerusalem, the pot, must experience the heat of God's wrath, which is accomplished through that Babylonian siege that we were just talking about. The remainder of this verse announces that what's going to happen to the Jewish people. The verdict? Exile. You see, it says, bring it out piece by piece, and it refers to individual inhabitants. Remember, not all of the inhabitants of Israel were taken all at once. When we did that reading in the first book of Kings, right? It was piecemeal out of everything, and there was still a remnant that was left behind. Now, along those lines, and we saw that in verse 14, talking about the men of valor, 10,000 captives, and all the craftsmen and smiths. Now, the choice cuts of meat, as we saw in verses 4 and 5, ends with no lot has fallen. God does not play favorites. His judgment would fall equally on all the inhabitants of the city, for they had all sinned. What does Romans 3:23 say? For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of our Lord. You may get away with your sin once, twice, for a season. However, God's judgments are perfect. Now, not in this world will we be judged and be standing before the throne, the judgment throne. However, thankfully, as Christians, we'll never be there. But we will still have to give an account for what we've done for his kingdom. So as we do that, let's be standing there a good long time. Does that sound good? All right. Not like Israel facing judgment, however. Verse 7. "For her blood is in her midst. She set it on top of a rock. She did not pour it out on the ground. It covered it with dust, that it may rise up fury and take vengeance. I have set her blood on top of a rock, that it may not be covered. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, woe to the bloody city. I too will make the pyre great. Heap on the wood, kindle the fire. Cook the meat well, mix in the spices, and let the cuts be burnt up. Then set the pot on the empty pot on the coals, that it may become hot, and its bronze may burn, that the filthiness may be melted in it, that its scum may be consumed. She has grown weary with lies, and her great scum has not gone from her. Let her scum be in the fire. In your filthiness is lewdness. Because I have cleansed you, and you were not cleansed. You will not be cleansed of your filthiness anymore, till I have caused my fury to rest upon you." So here we have that great analogy of the stew and the pot and the meat and the bones that were even fully cooked. Ezekiel was then to place that empty pot onto the fire as an illustration that not only would the people of Jerusalem experience God's wrath, but Jerusalem herself would be destroyed. Now, in verses 7 and 8, it elaborates on the city's sin of bloodshed. We saw that in verse 6 also. The people failed to deal with the sin, so God declared that it would remain exposed to his judgment. Now, this isn't the first time that we see God doing this. In Genesis 4, chapter 10, dealing with Cain after he slew Abel. After Abel slew Cain. Cain slew Abel. And said, and in verse 10 it says, "And he said, 'What have you done? The voice of your brother cries out to me from the ground. So now you are cursed from the earth, which has opened up its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you till the ground, it shall no longer yield its strength to you. A fugitive and a vagabond, you shall be on the earth.'" So we see God's judgment there. Then again, in Isaiah 26, verse 21, "For behold, the Lord comes out of his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity. The earth will also disclose her blood and will no more cover her slain." In verse 13 of our scripture, it stated, "Have cleansed you, and you were not cleansed." This, I believe, refers to the deportations in 605 BC and 597 BC, whose cleansing effects were incomplete. So remember, they didn't take everybody out of Israel. The Jews still continued in their idolatry and harlotry, as Matt had discussed last week. As such, there were the consequences: judgment and exile to Babylon. Continuing in verse 14, "I, the Lord, have spoken it. It shall come to pass, and I will do it. I will not hold back, nor will I spare, nor will I relent, according to your ways and according to your deeds. They will judge you, says the Lord God." Now, this actually sums up the whole reason why we study prophecy. We see that these predictions are made, told by God to Ezekiel, and what do you know? They all come true. You see, this is just one reason why we don't have a blind faith, or one that's believing just for the sake of believing. If God predicted something and then it didn't come true, then he wouldn't be an all-knowing, omnipotent God, transcendent and outside of all space and time, would he? But when God says the Messiah is going to be born in Bethlehem in Micah 5:2, and he is, then that's a God that we can trust in without reservation. Okay, so now God through Ezekiel, is going to shift gears again as we're going to look at an analogy between Israel and Ezekiel's wife. Let's think about Ezekiel's prophecy thus far in the book of Ezekiel. Over in verses 4 through 8, what does Ezekiel have to do? He has to lie on his side. Ezekiel has to lay on his side to demonstrate the length of Babylon's siege would correspond to the number of years Ezekiel had sinned against God. Then in chapter 4, verses 9 through 17, he was told to bake bread over dung. Dung fueled by a fire. Now, this would have been a huge offense to the Jews, but it was illustrating that their impending captivity would force them to eat polluted food that would mirror the filthiness of their sin. Then in chapter 5, verses 1 through 4, Ezekiel has to shave his head. He had to shave his head as a sign of mourning. The burning of a third of his hair would symbolize in the fires that God would destroy Jerusalem, as we discussed earlier. Then in 12, 17 through 28, quivering, trembling and shuddering as he ate, showed Ezekiel acting out the awful fear that the Jews would have to face when their enemies swept through the land. Now, as we're about to see here, he's going to lose his wife. And God refuses to let him mourn as a sign of the overwhelming sadness that the nation would feel when Jerusalem and the temple were destroyed. But let's think about it. The newspaper ad would read, "Prophet want it. Must be able to lie on your side for 390 days. Must be able to bake over dung. Shaved head's a plus, but not required, as this will be part of your ministry later. Travel provided via the Babylonian captivity expected. Loss of wife guaranteed. Who would apply for such a position? Who would say, here am I, send me? Yet Ezekiel does. Remember, we just went over the fact in Sunday how prophets weren't very well treated by Israel. Jesus even calls out the religious leaders on this fact. So in essence, God says, Ezekiel, this isn't going to be easy, but I need to take away the desires of your eyes. Your wife, I'm sorry. And you know, I think the rainbow and unicorns Christianity that way too many people preach can also be a disillusionment about our faith. See, it's not easy, is it, always serving God? There are sacrifices of time, finances, and yes, even family members. Those who will no longer talk to you because you're one of those. Oh, those Jesus freaks, those Bible thumpers, those holy rollers, those God botherers, those sea dogs. You just want to talk about Christ. Yes, and amen. But the next time you think that we've got it rough, think on Ezekiel and what God asked him to give. Ezekiel's ministry began when the Lord instructed him to eat a scroll of wool. Then he had to lay on his side for over a year, cut his hair, cook with cow manure, and then move out of his house. Yes, each of these actions were symbolic, intended to get the attention of a people who no longer listened to the preaching and the teaching of God's word. But the people still weren't listening. So his next assignment would be the heaviest of all. Not just time or finances, not just do a few strange activities, but Ezekiel, I'm going to need your wife too. Let's continue with verse 15. Also, the word of the Lord came to me saying, Son of man, behold, I take away from you the desire of your eyes with one stroke. Yet you shall neither mourn nor weep, nor shall your tears run down. Sigh in silence. Make no mourning for the dead. Bind your turban on your head and put sandals on your feet. Do not cover your lips and do not eat man's bread of sorrow. So I spoke to the people in the morning, and at evening, my wife died. And the next morning, I did as I was commanded. Wow. I mean, wow. How tough would that be? But you know what? In the military, in the heat of battle, when your friend falls next to you dead, there's no time to mourn. When you lose a fellow officer, a fellow friend in the line of duty, you can't just say, time out, stop the world, I want to get off. There's still a mission to be accomplished. Bad guys that still need to be arrested. Or as we used to say in the military, Charlie Mike, continue the mission. There will be a time to reflect later, but not now. For now, continue the mission. The boiling pot, or the pot is boiling. The Lord says to Ezekiel, but my people aren't listening. Therefore, tell them that I'm going to take your wife. The desires of your eyes, it speaks of a deep affection that Ezekiel would have had for his wife. Yet, he was not to mourn for her. He was to keep his turban on and not to cover his lower lip, as was the custom for those in mourning. You know, this reminds me a little bit of Leviticus 10. We see there that the tabernacle was being dedicated, fire descending from heaven to ignite the sacrifices on the altar. All of the people were blown away as they got to experience the glory of God. At that point, two of Aaron's sons lit their own fire to burn incense. When the Lord saw it, he struck them dead because they had disobeyed his command to use only fire from the altar in worship. Aaron was forbidden by the Lord to mourn for his sons because there was a job that he had to do and he must keep going. If you're serious in your desire to serve Jesus, you must learn the secrets of Leviticus 10 and Ezekiel 24. Your own personal emotions, your challenges and difficulties must not be allowed to interfere with your calling into the ministry God has opened up for you. I've seen bunches of people who, being checked out during times of difficulty, and then God sidelines them permanently. God gives us men and women who learn that the calling that they have, the gifts that they have been given, must not be compromised by personal problems or emotions. God makes us those who would set our face towards Jerusalem like flint. That's what Jesus did. Isaiah 1:7 states, "For the Lord God will help me. Therefore, I shall not be confounded. Therefore, I have set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be ashamed." And we see this actually coming to fruition in Luke 9:51, where it says, "And it came to pass when the time was come that he," Jesus, "should be received up. He steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem." Jesus knew he was going to be spat upon, punched, mocked, ridiculed, scourged, and ultimately crucified. He didn't sit there and go, "Well, Lord, I'm kind of struggling with this. This is kind of a lot for me to kind of handle just right now." No, instead, what does it say? He'd been given a mission and a ministry. And just as Jesus did, and not deterred, we need to be not deterred from what he would have to do with us. Verse 19. "And the people said to me, 'Will you not tell us what these things signify to us that you behave so?' Then I answered them, 'The word of the Lord came to me saying, speak to the house of Israel. Thus says the Lord God, behold, I will profane my sanctuary, your arrogant boast, the desire of your eyes, the delight of your soul, and your sons and daughters whom you left behind shall fall by the sword. And you shall do as I have done. You shall not cover your lips nor eat man's breads of sorrow. Your turban shall be on your head and your sandals on your feet. You neither mourn nor weep, but you shall pine away your iniquities and mourn with one another. Thus Ezekiel is assigned to you according to all that he has done, you shall do. And when this comes, you shall know that I am the Lord God." Ezekiel was to tell the people that what God had done in his life personally, God would do to Jerusalem nationally. Too many of us have the tendency to want to serve the Lord for benefits. But true servants are willing to forego healing if the Lord calls them to be an example to others of how to die, to suffer loss financially, if it means showing others that God alone is all they need. True servants like Ezekiel gives God permission to use their lives in whatever way may give him glory. Let's try to be less like the world, living for self, and more like Ezekiel, living for the Lord. Amen? Amen. Verse 25, as we wrap up. "And you, son of man, will it not be in the day when I take from them their stronghold, their joy, and their glory, the desire of their eyes, and that on which they set their minds, their sons and their daughters, that on that day, one who escapes will come to you to let you hear it with your ears. On that day, your mouth will be open to him who has escaped. You shall speak no longer, you shall speak and no longer be mute. Thus, you will be assigned to them, and they shall know that I am the Lord." See, this would be Ezekiel's last prophecy of God to the people until chapter 33, during which time then he would be prophesizing, still prophesizing, but to the surrounding nations. Just as he was not to mourn for his wife, he was to turn his attention from warning God's people to those outside of Judah until word came to him that Jerusalem had indeed fallen. But that's not going to happen until Ezekiel 33, Verse 21. Israel refused to listen to the warnings and the prophecies of Ezekiel. As we look around at the world today, are we seeing warnings? The prophecies starting to line up? Let me leave you with a question. What steps are you and your community taking to ensure that we avoid a similarity bad outcome? Pray on how God would use you. Then, be as bold, courageous, and stalwart as Ezekiel. Amen? Amen. Would you pray with me? Lord, all throughout your word, we see these mighty men of valor. We see these prophets who step up, who truly live a Christ-centered life, and the fact that they want to go ahead and put others before self. God, I pray that we would be able to glean from these individuals, glean from Ezekiel, to see all the hardships that he went through. And Lord, the hardships that we go through, they pale in comparison. So Lord, I pray that this would be an encouragement to each and every one of us in the fact that we can put up with so much more. You can prepare us for so much more. And God, that you would use us for so much more. Dear Lord, you are such a good God. You bless so abundantly. Lord, never let our comfort be a place of complacency, but instead, let us be used greatly and mightily for you. To you be all the glory, and it's in your precious name, Yeshua, Jesus, that we pray. Amen. If everyone would please stand for the last song.
I see the Lord seated on the throne, exalted, and the train of his robe fills the temple. Everybody, stay warm.